Welcome to the Heavy Spoilers Show. I'm your host Definition, aka the YouTuber who's always down for the count like a bad boxer. Castlevania Season 3 has just hit Netflix, and the show has a lot to unpack from it. Throughout this video, we'll be discussing the ins and outs of the season's plot, its ending, and where it leaves things off. We'll be letting you know our thoughts on whether it sucks worse than Dracula, or if this one is worth rising from the dead to watch. There will be heavy spoilers here, so if you haven't had a chance to see the show yet and don't want anything ruined, then I highly recommend that you turn off now. Make sure you subscribe to the channel for videos like this every day, and don't forget to hit the thumbs up button if you enjoyed the episode. Without the way, thank you for clicking this. Now let's get into our breakdown of Castlevania Season 3. Season 2 ended with Dracula dead and Alucard claiming the castle for himself. He sat in the halls of the area, sobbing, finally able to understand the despair that Dracula was going through. By the end of Season 3, the pieces are slowly starting to fall in place in terms of the side characters, but this aesthetic of despair is definitely a main driving force of the third entry. The season opens with Alucard trying to get adjusted to the lonely and isolated life that he will now be leading. I kinda got flashes of Thanos in Avengers Endgame from these scenes, and similar to the Mad Titan, Alucard has been left with little purpose after completing his goal. Losing his mind, he's made puppets of Trevor and Cypher, who he joined on the road hunting monsters. Season 3 really starts off showing the humanity of characters and how loss ultimately comes from a win. Victory leads to a lack of purpose, and our three main leads just feel like they're existing rather than achieving something. It's a unique way to kickstart the season, but the pair quickly gain a reason to come back after they arrive in Lindenfeld. I'll discuss the ins and outs of this later, but it's where they spend the majority of their time and also becomes instrumental in the ending of the show. Here they meet a mysterious count, the monks of the priory, and a character known as the judge that recruits them. Something is off about the village, and the number of missing children there makes it seem very, well, strange. Elsewhere, in the wake of the power vacuum left behind by Dracula's demise, everything is up in the air. Carmilla returns this time joined by her sisters, Lenore, Morana, and Striga. They seek to ravage the land, which now looks like it's theirs for the taking. They hold Hector captive, and though as a group, they're left with little to do overall in the 10 episodes, their military planning will definitely come to pay off further down the line. Lenore gains Hector's trust, and it's brilliant watching the complexities of the three-dimensional chess being played out by all characters in the show. Curse you, you sexy anime vampire! They wish to use Hector to raise an army for them, and I loved watching Lenore manipulate him into gaining Stockholm Syndrome and trusting her. He pledges his life to Lenore, and during one of the season's, let's say more intimate moments, she slips a ring on his finger. She gives ones to her sisters that have the ability to control the wearer of this ring, and through his Forgemaster abilities they can raise a new army of demons to enact their plans. Season 2 teased Carmilla becoming the new big bad, and she was clearly going against the grain of what was expected from the society that she existed in. Now that she has some allies to help her, it looks like she will certainly become a formidable foe for the characters in the show. Their arc in the season ends with them setting up a vampire war that is likely going to involve the next arc that we'll be talking about, that is, Isaac's. Isaac has been traveling the land after being banished to the desert. He wishes to find his way back to Hector to enact revenge, and accompanied by the army that he raised last time, he makes this journey, bumping into many characters along the way. I loved watching him debate humanity, talk with philosophers who were punished to hell, and out of all of the protagonists, I definitely found myself getting swept up in his story the most. There's another two arcs that I'll get into in just a bit, but they do such a good job of making every story gripping, especially Isaac's. He has to do this season pretty much on his own, and we learn through his counterpart Hector what Carmilla's plans are. We discover that she and her sisters wish to take over a large section of land, let humans inhabit it and breed, thus providing them with an endless supply of food. It's a simplistic plan, but also a brilliant one that elevates the season slightly above the other two in my opinion. By the end of the season, he discovers a mirror that will take him directly to Styria and the forces of Carmilla. It is likely that a big vampire war will ensue. I'll talk about this more in detail at the end of the video, but it definitely feels like things are ramping up. There exists pretty much four story arcs in the season, and there are highs and lows in all of them, but overall they come together in a way where they complement one another. It's difficult to really rank the seasons in comparison with one another, as this is by far the longest and most fleshed out, but With it missing Dracula, it is slightly harder to judge. I do feel like they really hit their stride here though, and the creative team have figured everything out, knowing when to take longer dramatic moments and when to make large-scale battles their center point. Either way, I got absolutely hooked by the show early on, and it's another great addition that expands on the prior two entries. In Trevor and Cypher's arc, we are introduced to Saint Germain, and he becomes a big part of the show. In Castlevania Curse of Darkness, Germain is a time traveler who has a wealth of knowledge on, well, everything. This is carried across to the show, and at several points we see him journeying to various moments in the past and future. He also knows how to use the old I was looking for the bathroom excuse when he gets caught somewhere he shouldn't. He knows what toilet paper is, and he gets to the bottom of one of the big mysteries in the season. He does look different to his gang counterpart, but you can actually see the red coat that he famously dons under his larger green one. He gains access to the Priory and begins to unearth the ins and outs of their belief system and what their goal for the season is. He forms an allegiance with Cypher and Trevor and sort of becomes the third man in the pair. The judge recruits Cypher and Trevor, and we discover that there's something very wrong with Lindenfeld. At the heart of the village lies a conspiracy to open a portal directly to Hell. This is through a doorway known as the Infinite Corridor. This system of doors to other lands leads to several moments in space and time, and after losing someone he cared about in there, Germain will do anything to get her back. By the looks of it, she's in the Belmont Library, which is buried beneath Alucard's castle, and this is likely where things will lead down the line. I loved watching him journey through the corridor during episode 6, as it's one of the trippiest moments in the show thus far. Long after I finished the season, it really stuck with me, and I would love to see him get an expanded role next time. Slowly, the trio begin to discover a symbol known as Saturn's symbol, which has been placed on the houses. This is known as a harvest symbol, and it represents what the monks plan to do with the village. Trevor and Cypher moaned about how they didn't have a purpose, but finally they have one that will save them from the boredom in which they've been trying to avoid. Mirroring this, Alucard forms a bond with two new characters, Zumi and Taka. He becomes a mentor to them, and the character finally gets a purpose, which sees him returning to the world of fighting vampires. He seeks to create a new generation of monster hunters, and I think he fits the role well of a hardened teacher that wants to make the world a better place. The two seem like they're going to fill the hole in Alucard's life, however their natures get the better of them, and as they learn Alucard's secrets, they start to become paranoid and believe that he will betray them. He was completely open and honest with them, but they're blindsided by their history. They lure him to bed and try to kill Alucard, but he gets the upper hand using magic. Their traumatizing pasts were really their undoing, and this is very much mirrored in Alucard himself. His arc in the season closes with him placing the two Japanese hunters on stakes at the entrance of his castle, showing that people are no longer welcome there. Alucard started off as a kind and gentle person who really was a good egg. However, he is slowly starting to become his father, and much like Taka and Zumi, the past has become very influential on his future. He will likely remain in the castle, feeling even more alone and isolated now, and this is similar to the arc that Dracula himself went on. All of the pieces are in place for him to become a big vampire, and with the war that is on the horizon, I can see him providing a formidable side to it. As for Trevor and Cypher, the season closes with them heading to the Priory to take down a night creature that's been held by the monks. The houses with the symbols on them set on fire, and the souls of the dead within them power the beast in the basement and allow it to open a portal to the domain. The town gets transformed into a battlefield, and it's a brilliant watch. In the basement of the church, the three go up against the forces that emerge, and the monks almost manage to achieve their endgame, which is to pull Dracula out of the underworld. Just before Dracula reaches out, the portal closes for him, but it does show that there is indeed a way to bring the character back. Germain manages to get to the library, and he gets his happy ending with his long lost love. He says thank you and I'll see you again, which I think indicates that he will be in the library and that the two will unearth this next time, potentially after they return to Alucard. He's the only person who gets a happy ending, and this season, as I said, is very much about despair. Outside, the two discover that the judge has been stabbed by the leader of the monks, and he requests they burn his house down. Though the monk leader Salar gets his comeuppance, the pair discover that the judge has his own secrets. They learn that he's been luring children to his apple tree and killing them with a spike trap. In his home, they unearth a room full of children's shoes, and they are all victims of the character who too was as evil as the monks. It's a really, really dour way to end things, and similar to Alucard, the two lose their hope in humanity. Now going forward, we have four sides that I think will all be going head to head in the next entry. Isaac is of course going to face down against the sisters and their army, and I think they may end up destroying one another. I'm not sure how the season will go, as it slowly started diverting from the source material whilst keeping other elements in place. All Isaac has to do is kill Hector, and then the control that the sisters have over their forces will be lost, but it will likely take its toll on Isaac, who I can see potentially perishing too. In the wake of this, Alucard will be left as the new Dracula, who rules over the entire land due to both sides perishing. Because of his distrust in humanity, I can actually see him becoming the big bad that Trevor and Cypher may have to go up against. I'm not 100% on that, but I think it would add an interesting dynamic to see them have to fight one another. If the theory on the Belmont Library is correct, then that would mean that Trevor and Cypher will cross paths with Alucard at one point, and now he's got a no trespassing rule, he will likely be unwelcoming to them. As I've said 1,000 times, I think we're heading for a big vampire war that will end up with there being a power vacuum once more, and in the wake of it, the 3 central characters will once more become the focus. If the ending made you abandon all hope, then don't worry, because I think we're in for an incredible season 4. Now before we get into the review, I just want to let you know we're giving away a free copy of the Infinity Saga box set to one random subscriber. All you have to do to be in with a chance of winning is like the video, subscribe to the channel, and leave your thoughts on the show in the comments section below. The winner is going to be chosen at random on the 15th of March, and the set will be shipped out from then to whoever gets the prize, so best of luck to everyone who takes part. Okay, so as for my thoughts on the show, as I'm sure you can tell, I absolutely loved it. Castlevania gets better every entry, and as soon as the season ends, I'm left feeling like Alucard, alone, and devastated that it's over. This was a brilliant addition, and I really hope that things continue this way going forward. There's tons of avenues that could be explored, and overall, season 3 for me delivered in every way. It's very difficult to fault it, and the feeling that it left me with the end, and therefore it gets a 9 out of 10. Now obviously I'd love to hear your thoughts on Castlevania Season 3 and what you thought of the ending. Comment below and let me know, and if you enjoyed this video then please give it a thumbs up, and make sure you check out our breakdown of Picard, which is going to be linked at the end. We cover a whole host of TV shows, so it's definitely worth sticking around if you enjoyed this video. If you want to support the channel from as little as 99 cents a month, then please click the join button below. We massively appreciate it, and as a thank you, you get access to content early. If you want to come chat to us after the show, either follow us at DefinitionYT or click the Discord link in the description below. Those are the best ways to keep up to date with heavy spoilers, so hopefully we see you over there very soon. This is a channel for people who are never missing television, so if that's the kind of thing you like, you need to subscribe to Definition. Thanks again for taking the time to watch this, you've been the best, and I'll see you next time. Take care, peace.